For this third panel, the theme is looking across. Our speakers will reflect on the core values that have shaped our society and the way we deal with social diversity. Chairing this panel is IPS Deputy Director Gillian Koh, and I will now hand over to her to introduce this panel and the speakers. Dr. Koh?
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I have the great pleasure of introducing to you the next panel. It's a series of three very important questions that cause us to ponder on how we will manage our social diversity as we look into the future. The future, remember, year 2065. My speakers have asked me to relieve them of the burden of sharing some basic data about Singapore, I think, which is a necessary context for our discussion this afternoon. So with your indulgence, let me take you through some of the data about our religious and racial diversity, the diversity of our peoples, and then finally come to the question of family and what does it do. So let us quickly begin. Looking across our social diversity to year 2065. The current picture of our breakdown of citizens based on ethnic group suggests that not much has changed in terms of the ethnic proportions between 2006 and 2016. I think you can see the figures there for yourself, fairly static. When we do the proportions based on the resident population, you will see that there's, remember, everything is relative, a relative decrease in the number of Chinese in the resident population, which includes citizens and permanent residents, and a slight increase in the Indian and others category within this resident population. When we look at the diversity of our people in terms of their religion, you know that Singapore is the most diverse set of people on the planet, right? And what you see over time from 2000 to 2010 to 2015 is a reduction, all things being relative, in the proportion of Buddhists, but an increase in the proportion in our resident population of Christians, Taoists, Hindus, and the people who say they have no religion, a very significant proportion at 18.5% of this resident population. Now, we know that these are just basic numbers, but the spread, and most importantly, the depth of the sense of affinity to these different forms of identity on race, on religion, and of course, on linguistic divisions is not reflected in these numbers. So let's bear that in mind. And we know that from session 1 to 2, we're talking about a world in which we see the reactivation of some of the identities around race and a reassertion of identities around religion. This leads us to the first question, which my very dear friend, Dr. Norman Vasu, will address. That question is, what if, in looking to Singapore in 2065, we ignore race and religion? Let me say a little bit about Norman, who will speak first. He's the Senior Fellow, Coordinator of the Social Resilience Program, and the Deputy Head of the Center of Excellence for National Security at the S. Rajaratnam School of International Studies at the Nanyang Technological University. He is there at SENS. That's what Center for National Security stands for. We consider a sister think tank. So thank you, Norman, for doing this and for being here. Now let's move to the next form, a very important form. We talk about race, religion. Certainly what's been even more exciting in terms of political and social activation in Singapore is the identity around nationality. Here's a basic chart that takes you through the changes in the nationality status of the people in Singapore cast your eye to the percentages in the role for citizens, and you see the changes from 2000, where citizens comprised 74.1% of the population, to 2016, when citizens comprise about almost 61%. So it's quite a significant change. With the population under the category of others, you see the progression from 2000 of 18.7% to 2016, where the proportion of others comprises close to 30%. Many of our friends from the business sector will feel this change very acutely. This is a counterpoint to what you just saw, right? You saw the distribution of non-citizens rising, but the rate of increase in the foreign workforce in Singapore has been falling by design, by policy design. And you see the blocks go down with a tiny uptick in 2015 to 2016, which is attributed to the rise in the number of foreign domestic workers as we age as a population. And this will, Leng, this will be a nice segue to what you're going to talk about as well. So there you have it. The total population is grinding down in terms of the growth rate. What do I mean by policy? Some of you may feel that this is a nightmare, but I will remind you of the population white paper, where the long-term planning of the government has been set out with regard to population policy. First, on the presumption that Singaporeans should want good jobs and a vibrant economy, and that 60% of our population want to be PMEs by the year 2030, and that Singaporeans will always comprise two-thirds of the workforce. Then, with the assumption that productivity will grow between 2 to 3% in this decade and 1 to 2% in the next decade, and wishing to maintain that economic vibrancy, then the suggestion is that the foreign workforce can only be raised to a range of 1 to 2% in this decade and kept at no more than 1% in the next decade. With the presumption that we have very low fertility rates, and even if we to raise them, then to keep some level of economic vibrancy and local workforce growth, then the suggestion is to raise the citizen numbers by between 15 to 25K each year. What's the outcome? Well, these are the projections that we have been working on, that the government has been working towards. For this decade, if the range of productivity growth is between 2 to 3%, workforce growth 1 to 2%, then GDP growth will fall within the range of 3 to 5%. And our business friends in the room will have to answer the question of whether we have been able to achieve that productivity growth. Looking at the future, 2020 to 2030, the presumption is that productivity growth will range from 1 to 2%, and if the workforce growth is kept at 1%, then we manage a very mature economy rate of growth of 2 to 3%. Understanding that we're working from a very high base of one of the richest, most competitive economies of the world, then this is a 2 to 3% on a very high performing engine. So the key question is this, and this was probably one of the hottest topics in 2013. Sorry for reviving it, because the rest of the world is also asking this question. What if we cease to accept immigrants? And to address this question, we're so pleased to have Ms. Mariam Jaafar share with us her thoughts. Ms. Mariam Jaafar is partner and managing director of the Boston Consulting Group in Singapore. She's a core member of the technology and media and telecommunications and financial services practice here. And guess what? Since we are profiling all our speakers, Mariam, though you went to Stanford, you had a liberal arts exposure, Mariam is really the only engineer on our speaker's podium today. She's also a member of the Committee on the Future, which is due to report before the budget. She is a member of, or the co-chair of, the Subcommittee on the Future of Connectivity. So we'll welcome you to address this very tough question, Mariam, in a little while. Finally, to wrap, let me go to the data on the last question. We've talked about race, religion, nationality, but really, if we look at the way Singapore's designed, there is a lot of social policy that is undergirded by our concept of family. We know that we are a very low fertility, ultra-low fertility country. And in the year 2015, the total fertility rate was 1.24 births per female in her productive age. In 2014, it was 1.25. So while we have raised it from very, very low levels, it's still not very high. For those of you who are familiar with it, this is the age pyramid, which shows you with each bar the proportion of people that are within those ages in the center. And the question is, how can we support that bulge in the center, which is growing further and further upwards with a smaller base? So we're looking at an inverted pyramid with fewer young people to support more senior people. Of course, looking at Prof. Wang, he will ask, what's wrong? The seniors will take good care of themselves. But let us look at this question right across the board, across the nation, for every senior that you can think of and every young person you can think of. How will we cope across the country? Just two more slides. Here is some data that is drawn from a survey that IPS does regularly on how our seniors are aging. In the top column, you see that for those who are age 55 and above and were asked the question, what is the extent to which you rely on money from your children for your daily support? In 2005, it was 66% who said they rely on their children, and in 2011, it was really no different at all. Final slide is drawn from the General Household Survey of 2015, and in the first set of charts under allowances given by children, a sample of resident population aged 65 years and above were asked, how do they support themselves? Across the board among males and females, 52% said that they relied on their children, and when you break it down by gender, 61.6% of the women who were surveyed said they relied on children. So let's agree that the family is important for many things, but even in the most basic question of social support, we find that the reliance on family and children has been a very integral part of how our seniors age well. So the question is, over the next 50 years, what if family is no longer the fundamental building block of society? On this topic, we are again very, very pleased to have a dear and old friend of IPS, Dr. Thang Leng, address the topic. She's Deputy Director of the Center for Family and Population Research at NUS, a social anthropologist and a practitioner. Okay, IPS is coming up, is going to use this term quite often, a pracademic. So she's a practitioner who does social service on the ground, but she's also an academic. So we really welcome pracademic Thang Leng addressing this third question. So with that, can I just invite you to encourage Norman to come and be bold in his thoughts. He has 15 minutes. Norman, what if we ignore race and religion? Norman.
Okay, good afternoon. I'd like to thank IPS for inviting me to come to speak, as well as for organizing such an important conference. Special thanks as well go out to Gillian for making this job for me so easy, making me the first speaker after lunch, always an easy job. Second reason, come and speak to a huge audience about race and religion, not very sensitive topic in Singapore. And then also, while you're at it, look 50 years into the future. Soothsaying is easy too. Special thanks to you, Gillian, really. So you're going to think about what if we ignore race and religion in the Singaporean context? And this is a perennial question that comes up all the time in Singapore. Can we look past race and religion? And I suspect probably where it really came to the fore was when Rajaratnam passed and everybody got reawakened to the pledge, and everybody was thinking, can we become what the pledge aspires us to be? Another moment in time where this question probably memorably came up was 2009. As mentioned earlier in one of the questions for the other panel. So the NMP, Viswa, in Parliament suggested that perhaps we should throw our energy into returning to the pledge as a core belief, where we consider these things as inalienable values. To put it mildly, he got quite a nasty smackdown, and his views were branded as highfalutin, and how the pledge, and it was a dangerous view, and how the pledge is basically an aspiration, and it's going to take years and years, hundreds of years, I believe is the exact quote, to work at it, where we become both race and blind religion and race. So this is the premise, I would suggest, is the starting point in thinking about race and religion in Singapore now as well as into the next 50 years. That the premise here is that race and religion, these two things are the key components that customarily fill up the basket called culture, right? And culture here is seen as largely primordial, right? It is present. It is there, it is unchanging, it is static. Culture gives us things to celebrate. But however, culture as well can be dangerous, and it can lead us to conflict, as we've seen in Singaporean history in the past. So this is the premise, the starting point for I think how we approach the multicultural in Singapore. So how do we do it, right? We go about it in academic literature, you would refer to it as hard multiculturalism. We aren't unique. This is done as well in states like Australia, Canada, and the UK. The belief here is that because culture is so important, race and religion is lived and believed, right? A government then has no choice but to manage it. So politics has no choice but to enter into the field of culture and manage it, to help people get along. To a large degree, it's seen as like a Rawlsian primary good. You need culture, you need understanding of race and religion in order to help you navigate the world, right? It gives you a manner in which to make sense of the world and your place in it. So, do we ignore race and religion in Singapore right now? We don't, right? Hard multiculturalism, once again, politics has no choice but to enter the sphere of culture and manage it to help people get along, to build a more cohesive society. These things weren't naturally evolved by themselves. So, I mean, I apologize to the Singaporeans who probably know everything up there and the bullet points, but I'll go through them one by one. So the idea here, the premise, like I said, is that we need to work at it and the government needs to step in. So we have housing quota policies, for example, for the HDB. Social harmony is not natural. Perhaps some folk would like to cluster amongst their own ethnic or religious group. And so we have housing quotas for the Housing Development Board to spread people out with the belief that our spatial interaction then leads to social interaction and it leads to deepening of bonds between the different races. Then we have racial self-help groups, right? The premise, once again, is that culture is special. There's something special about a particular ethnic group, and only they understand their problems, right? They understand their problems to a greater degree than anybody else can. So it's best that we have these self-help groups so they can manage their own problems and their own understandings of their problems. Then we have the GRCs, right? So it moves into the political sphere here because we want to manage culture. So we have the GRCs, and what the GRCs prevent here is that if Singaporeans wake up collectively mad on election day and decide to vote along racial lines, we're still going to get some minority representation in parliament. Elected presidency, I mean, this was hot for a few months ago. And the idea here is if people do continually vote on race, we might not get a minority president, so we've got to make these tweaks and changes. And then finally, you know, it goes into the sphere of education as well. Culture is so important, right? Race is so important, and these are key components to this thing, in this basket called culture, but you've got to fill it with other things, and you fill it with things like language. So yeah, that's why you have the mother tongue policy in Singapore. So the Chinese learn Mandarin, and Malay is Malay, and the Indians have a bigger spread, I admit that. So this is the state of play where we are right now. So if we want to think into the future, is this the only game in town? I'll offer two alternatives, and we'll see whether it gets any traction with the crowd. So your alternatives here would be two. The first one is revolution, and the second one is evolution. So with revolution here, what can be suggested is that we shift, we move. This is just a complete flip side to the current model, right? The state, instead of having truck with culture, detaches itself completely. The state practices something called benign neglect and is difference blind. The state's not interested in whether cultures flourish. It's not interested in whether cultures thrive or die. The state's only interested in attending to its citizens as citizens. That's it. It has no role in steering culture or ensure its survival. So culture here, and this, the premise here is culture is it's important. You don't have to say that culture is unimportant. It's important, but you step back and say, okay, but it is something for people. It's a private sphere issue, and you have to go find your own good life, and the state shouldn't meddle. Yeah, there are pros and cons to this, right? The first, of course, the first pro is this. This is there's a lot of optimists like this. They see it as a way of moving past, become a post-racial kind of society. So the state has to move away from it. People can find their own good life. Race slowly ebbs away. That's a pro. The con, of course, is then it's open to accusations like, but there is, there are real life, you know, no, not talking in terms of theory and abstract here. People do live race out on the street, they do live religion out on the street, and there are issues with that. So while, you know, the approach is optimistic, it's perhaps naive, quixotic and utopian. So that's one of the cons for the revolution approach, the approach where we practice something called benign neglect. Alternative two that we may want to consider here is something is evolution. It's evolution on the current Singaporean model. What I'm suggesting here is that we have targets rather than quotas for perhaps, you know, occupations or perhaps educational qualifications. And the target here is to arrive at a situation where occupations will reflect the actual racial demographic of Singapore, or perhaps educational qualifications will reflect the racial demographic of Singapore. So there's a clear target, and we're approaching this. When I had a conversation with Gillian about what I was going to present, she described it as the Singaporean model on steroids. Right, it's what we call it, Singapore Plus. Yeah, I expected to get a chuckle out of that one, but clearly not. Okay, so like I said, this is a Singapore Plus model. We set targets, and perhaps we want a racial demographic to be represented in particular in occupations, or perhaps educational qualifications. What are the pros of this? What are the benefits of having something like this? Well, one of the benefits of this is that if there was a Singaporean culture, it would really gel with the Singaporean culture because it would be a KPI, and we are a KPI-obsessed nation. So we know what we want to achieve, and we should try to work towards it, right? It's also kind of interesting approach as well, because as opposed to quotas, right, that tries to fix an outcome, what you're forced to do with the target is think through the structures that may be, there may be impediments to reaching a particular outcome. So you're forced to attend to those. Another benefit from this is that it possibly is psychological. You know, if you guys, well, in the 80s in the US, right, the constant lament for African-American culture was that young African-American boys had nothing to aspire to and nothing positive to look forward to aspire to, because all everybody that they could look up to was either a gangbanger or a sportsman, right? That's why the Cosby Show was a big deal, right? I mean, now we would, of course, have an issue with that, but you get the idea. You have to see a middle-class African-American family on TV. You know? So that's another positive. It's psychological. You see, you see the world kind of similar to what you see around you, and you can aspire to it. What are the cons of this? Okay, the cons for this is very similar, because it's basically the Singapore model. We're adopting it and we're trying to tweak it. So it comes with the same problems as the current model will have, you know, and the current model is open to the accusation that it is actually, because you attend so much, right? If you attend so much to all these spheres of life, right? What you're effectively doing unwittingly is entrenching difference, because people live difference all the time. So the development of commonality becomes very difficult. It's impeded by this desire to help. So it's kind of ironic that way. So, but you know, is a model nonetheless, and perhaps it will gel with the way we tend to approach things in Singapore, which is a very pragmatic way of approaching these issues, where you set a target and you try to achieve it by the most efficient means possible. So what I've done here, I'm running out of time, what I've done here is given you three possibilities to begin the conversation, right, effectively. The first one is we keep what we have as it is. It's a piecemeal fix to this. It's a Burkean in its approach. We just tweak it as we go, what we need to attend to when it comes up, we attend to it. And then the one option, one alternative to that, like I said, is a radical overhaul, right? We change everything. And the state steps back. By the way, another con which I didn't mention about the benign neglect model is that I think people fail to realize how hard it is for Singapore if we were to step back, right? And if the state step back, because you have to undo all these policies as well. So it will upset the balance quite radically. And it'll take a lot of bureaucratic energy to unwind all that. And then the third thing that I've offered here is this idea of evolution, as opposed to radically overhauling the current approach. We may want to consider moving it forward via this idea of targets. So I'll end on that note. Look forward to having the discussion Q&A later. Thank you.
Thank you for inviting me to today. This is my first time attending the Singapore Perspectives, and it's been really interesting so far. So when I first told one of my fellow panelists which topic I would be speaking about today, his response was, how did you draw the short straw on that one? So Gillian, I will echo Norman. Thank you very much. But I will try. So what if? What if Singapore were to cease to accept immigrants? Well, perhaps the unsatisfactory answer is it depends. This is a difficult question to answer. It depends partly on some global trends beyond our control and partly on some things that are within our control, like our domestic policy responses and our achievements together as a nation. Now, what makes it most interesting is that the things that are beyond our control today are complicated by the unprecedented level of uncertainty in the world today. And I'll identify four big uncertainties, which I think now are actually quite well known. So first, technology. Today, prototypes already exist for self-flying cars, you know, robotic garbage collectors, doctors that are really just artificial intelligence, exoskeleton suits. But you know, there's still a lot of uncertainty over how this new wave of automation technologies like AI, robotics, big data, will all play out. Take, for example, general artificial intelligence, the holy grail of AI. So the experts say this may be 20 years out, or it may be 150 years out. That's quite a big spread. Right? So much of the conversation today is about how technology will take away a significant number of jobs, both blue and white collar jobs. Some estimates say 47%. And indeed, many of the activities that we do today will become obsolete, including many of the labor-intensive tasks done by immigrants today. But we also hear that some jobs will be transformed because these new tools will make humans more productive rather than replacing them, and some new jobs will be created. The thing is, exactly what those transformed or new jobs are, how many there will be, when they will come, well, how can we know the future? But we do know how technology evolves will have a huge impact on how we think about jobs for residents and immigrants. So technology is the first big uncertainty. The other three uncertainties are social, political, and economic in nature. First one, will globalization and international cooperation that we heard talked about earlier today pick up from here, or will we regress to protectionism over the next 50 years? Secondly, will income inequality continue to grow, or will we find a way to get to a path to inclusive growth? And third, will polarization, this disturbing trend that's continuing to take root today, continue to take root, or can we actually rebuild trust so that we can become more cohesive again and go back to the politics of we? So those are four big uncertainties: technology, globalization, income inequality, and societal divisiveness. Which way they go depends not only on globalization and technology, but the institutions, policies, and politics that the big economies of the world engage in. As a small city state, Singapore is highly exposed to these uncertainties, and how we our domestic policy responses and how we adapt will be critical. Now, what I want to do next is actually draw a 2x2 matrix. You know where my firm, the Boston Consulting Group, popularizes the cash cow matrix. I'm not going to talk about the cash cow. I'm going to talk about a science fiction matrix, since we're talking about a 50-year scenario here. So if you make a 2x2 matrix with, on the y-axis, technology, and then social, political, and economic development on the x-axis, where on the right, you have progressive, integrated, and inclusive development, and on the left, you have regressive, divided, and unequal development, well then, you know, in the top right, you get this great AI society, where technology has advanced significantly and created awesome opportunity and productivity. General AI and robotics have become pervasive and broadly replace human workers in many activities. But they've also created new models of value creation in an advanced digital economy where the marginal cost of production is low or near zero. The economic adjustments from displacements have been smooth and the benefits well distributed, allowing prosperous, sustainable, inclusive, and long lives for all of us. Talent, capital, ideas are fully mobile across national boundaries. And like the utopia in H.G. Wells' novel, Men Like Gods, the concept of the nation-state has weakened with the rise of decentralized, self-organizing communities that transcend national boundaries. Now, below that, what if you don't get this discontinuities in technology? Well, that's my incremental diffusion scenario, or my what I call my back to the future scenario, because you know we still don't have those hoverboards. So technology here, you get technology allowing a gradual increase in automation and software tools that support people in their day-to-day work and improves quality of life. But the slower pace of change here helps to create better predictability and certainty for governments and businesses to plan. Globalization has continued, goods, capital, talent, fully mobile, facilitated by regional and pan-regional cooperation. Now, if I move to the left side of the matrix, on the top, you get what we call a divided dystopia. Here, the benefits of technology are significant, but they have entrenched power in corporations and a few wealthy elite. Machines have pushed the majority into joblessness and poverty. The middle class is gone. Economic and digital divides have led to regular social disturbances and toppled many governments, causing people to turn inwards and put up barriers to globalization and trade. Finally, on the bottom right, The balkanized ecosystems, this is an Orwellian future where the world is in a state of perpetual conflict. Economic and political unions have all broken down. The EU is no more, global FTAs, you know, all ripped up. Recurring cyber attacks have caused governments to restrict the internet, moderating the advance of technology. Productivity is low, and the general standard of living is lower as consumer goods are scarce and expensive and available mostly to the upper classes in an unequal society. So each of these scenarios present different opportunities and challenges, and they require different policy responses. And how we respond to them could lead to very different national outcomes. For example, in a great AI society, if we close our doors to the best high-skilled talent and entrepreneurs who are going to create these new innovations, it is likely that we will fall behind, because they will go, they are free to go wherever they want, to whatever countries will welcome them. Whereas if we go out to attract and retain the best of them, perhaps the next Google might yet be started in Singapore. And by the best global talent, I mean both foreigners and Singaporeans. Because you know, as the concept of the nation state weakens, how do you build that connection back to your diaspora becomes really important. Now, whether we choose on the lower end, whether we choose to accept immigrants or not, well, it doesn't really matter. There are no jobs, they won't come anyway. Right? So in this scenario, if we were to see by saying a blanket restriction on immigration, you would probably lead to Singapore losing competitiveness and subpar growth. So the answer to what, my answer at least, to what I feel, if what if Singapore were to cease to accept immigrants? It depends on how these scenarios play out, and our domestic policy responses will determine the impact on the growth of the economy. Now, I think it's important to actually, you know, just crystallize one premise here, and that is, you know, immigration is all premise on growth for me. And why does growth matter? As Jeremy discussed earlier, there are many other non-economic indicators that matter, that measure a country's progress and well-being. My firm has a sustainable economic development assessment framework. It tracks 43 different indicators. So growth is not all that matters, but it's also true that growth does matter. And today, with the global growth being so anemic, I think perhaps growth matters a little bit more. You need growth to keep up with inflation, and you also need growth to give, but even more importantly, you need growth to give opportunities and hope to everyone, businesses, but especially the young. Now, Singapore is no longer enjoying exceptional growth. So we're not talking about the difference between 6% and 7% here. We're talking about the difference between 2% and 3%, or perhaps even 1% and 2%. And at these levels, a 1% difference makes a heck of a lot of a difference. Just to illustrate this, you know, in 2014, the US economy grew by 2.4%. At that rate, it will take the US 30 years to double income per capita. In 2011, the growth rate was 1.6%, just 0.8% less. At that rate, it will take 44 years to double income per capita, a 14-year difference. So over 10 years, this difference of less than 1% leads to 3,300 in lost annual consumption per capita for households, you know, more than enough, I think, for that year-end holiday or to pay down the student loans, 1.1 trillion in lost revenues for firms, and along with that, market valuation, and 1.6 trillion in lost GDP, impacting growth opportunities and, amongst other things, of course, the ability to fund social safety nets. So this is just a quick recap. So bringing us back to today, the numbers that you saw from Gillian tomorrow, I think we know that without immigration, our population and our workforce will be smaller and older, and this will have a potentially big impact on the growth and vitality of our economy. Now, in the course of the CFE process, we had passionate discussions about talent to support the future economy, including the role of foreign manpower. I won't preempt the CME, the CFE, but let me share with you some of the concerns we heard on this topic. So we heard a lot about the need to attract talent from across the globe in areas like digital transformation, data sciences, cybersecurity. These are all new growth areas. We heard the concerns of SMEs who fear for their survival and the missed opportunities as a result of not being able to hire enough workers. One idea was to cut the economies, the companies that do want to transform some slack. We also heard from foreigners who spoke about Singapore as actually the best place to be right now. but who also expressed concerns over talent restrictions that hinder their ability to grow their businesses, and also unpredictable policy and regulatory changes that hinder their ability to plan. What they would like to see is genuine efforts to build the local talent pipelines recognized and rewarded. But of course, we also appreciate the opposing views, the worry about competition, about the lack of opportunities for locals, the challenges of integration, and even the need to avoid corporate welfareism that prevents the weeding out of inefficient businesses. In the long term, however, I think there's agreement that the need to move the economy to higher skills, higher productivity, and to reduce the dependency on foreign labor is clear. But first, let's look back a bit at history. We know that, I think Singapore's challenges in terms of productivity growth are well known. But if we look back at history and take a supply side view, we know that labor input in the years past, quite a lot fueled by immigration, has been a big part of the story. Since 2011, with the tightening of immigration, we have seen a sharp drop in the labor contribution, initially aimed at reducing low-skilled immigration, but more recently also reaching the high end. And with this drop, along with the drop in capital investment, we've seen lower GDP growth. Now, is there another way? Of course. If we want to cease accepting immigrants and yet want to our economy to grow, we can increase birth rates, increase labor force participation to offset immigrant growth. Unfortunately, this hasn't been the case in recent years, at least not on a sustainable basis. Otherwise, we would need more capital and particularly more productivity growth. You can't get away from productivity. Yet, the former has been declining amid the current slowdown, and the latter is growing very slowly across all economies. Now, this global decline in productivity growth actually is a bit of a paradox. We all live in a world of technological progress. So if technology progress has been so rapid, why has productivity growth gone down, or at least been slow? Now, we actually looked at the data in the US and came up with six different explanations for it. A changing sector mix that with more going to less productive sectors, slower diffusion of innovation across firms in the economy, lower investment, expiring one-off productivity gains from previous waves of technology, skills gaps holding back productivity growth in some sectors, and finally, measurement challenges. That is, productivity is improving, we're just measuring it wrong. And part of this, for example, is because of distorted pricing. Now, we haven't done this for Singapore, but I think we've seen that many of the same explanations hold. Of course, we shouldn't extrapolate today's constraints to the future, but the question remains, if we turn off the tap today, where will growth come from? Now, if we look at a few examples, say Japan. I think Japan's economic miracle years were always held up as an example of how productivity growth can allow really rapid growth without a high immigration ratio, less than 0.5%. But now, after the last two decades, even Japan is seeing that they need to start accepting immigrants as their population shrinks and ages rapidly. So, some have framed the solution to Japan's demographic challenges as a choice between robots on one hand and immigration. A lot is said about money that is being put into robots, but Japan is also taking steps to open up to foreigners, like you've seen last week with construction sector, foreign domestic help, and even now skilled workers can apply for PR after just 1 year. Just take a little bit more time, Gillian. In contrast to the US, we often think of it as an example of a nation of immigrants, but actually if you look, US immigration has always gone through multiple waves of immigration, followed by lulls, driven by social, political, and demographic factors. I think the most interesting thing about the US experience is the immigrant entrepreneur. This is the crowning achievement of US immigration, at least in my book. So, if you consider the stats from a 2013 National Venture Capital Association study, between 2006 and 2012, immigrants started 33% of US venture-backed companies that went public, a total of 92 such companies. These are companies like Google, Facebook, LinkedIn, Tesla. The value created by these companies is extraordinary, a total market cap of $900 billion. Now, if these companies were a country, their market cap would rank them 16th in the world in terms of the stock exchange, higher than Russia, South Africa, Taiwan, and yes, higher than Singapore. And these companies employ approximately 600,000 people, the majority of which are in the US. So as you can see, I think, you know, the question of immigration is a tough one. You put a gun to my head, can we cease to accept immigrants today? I think I will venture to say probably not. But exactly how much more we need, or you know, I think that actually is a question that will take a lot more data and actually take a lot more alignment on what we, as a country, want our growth rates to be. Unfortunately, that's a question for our politicians and not for me, at least to facilitate. So just last point, some implications. I think the important point, if we believe these scenarios and how quickly things are changing, the most important thing is for our immigration policy to be adaptive. You know, reading change signals, course correcting, driving experimentation, having feedback loops. And so, for example, you would look at, on the technology side, look at the evolution of the exponential laws of technology, Moore's law, Crider's law, Butter's law, look at how AI evolves, right? On the economic development side, look at what happens to global trade flows, the EU, look what happens to free trade agreements. And finally, I think, you know, I think the second major implication for me is, don't just protect the Singapore core, elevate it. And whether you are government, business, unions, or citizens, or immigrants, I think we all owe ourselves, you know, to actually try this. And I think the last thing I'd just say is, for the immigrants out there, you know, you can do your part. Integrate and embrace the Singapore culture. From my experience, very few immigrants participate in any kind of public dialogue on immigration, although many of them actually talk about it in private. In the spirit of you know, this national discourse, I think it's time we broaden it. So do share your stories and your aspirations. And I think we'll find more commonalities than differences. And hopefully with that, actually be able to talk about immigration with a bit more rationality and empathy on all sides. Thank you.
Thank you, Mariam. Good, my mic is on. They've allowed me to say something now. Thank you so much for that. Thank you, Norman, also for your presentation just now. Over to Leng Leng, please. You have 15 minutes. Thank you.
Hello, good afternoon. Thanks. Really, thank you to IPS and especially to Gillian for this opportunity to ponder upon the family, an institution that's considered quite a given and in our lives and entrenched in the Singapore policy. But of course, the question here, Gillian keep telling us, is what happened in 2065? Will it stay the same, say, in 2065? Now, first, let's take a look at the slides here. Gillian shows the 2016 pyramid. That's the one on the right. But we can see how it has changed over the years from a pyramid to something that's quite unlike a pyramid now, and how that is the basis of all our concerns and worries about the future. So this one, I want to show you about three countries, Japan, Singapore is in the middle, and then Thailand. Japan has been a very fascinating case study for many of us in looking at aging especially. And by 2016, it has already been, you know, the shape is actually quite distinctively different from the other two. And I think Thailand is very interesting because Thailand is really experiencing rapid aging that we may not have noticed. You know, all of us, I think, go to Thailand for holiday and you think there are a lot of young people, but it is aging at a rapid rate. The total fertility rate in 2015 is 1.5. Japan is 1.4 and Singapore was 1.25. Okay, so this is 2065. Japan, Singapore, Thailand. Can you see the difference? So by 2065, we are all the same as an aging society with, I think, if we are looking at this, I think they don't include immigration considerations or numbers and that, but you can see that Singapore actually have a very narrow base of young people there. So the fact is, you know, all these countries will be top-heavy aging society, and then how will family change by 2065? It is common when we discuss about social cultural changes in Singapore to state that family is changing. Then the question is, would the change lead to the scenario where family is no longer the fundamental block of society? And here, when we talk about change, it could mean changing structure, which is quite common where we talk about how family size is changing to be smaller. There are more people who are living alone now, more one-person households compared to before. And it could also refer to changing value, where people feel that the value of filial piety, defining intergenerational family support, has weakened. And people in their 50s, belonging to the sandwich generation, often like to see themselves as the last generation of the filial children, because they will still hold a sense of responsibility in caring for their elder parents, but they cannot expect the same from the children in the future. And another way to look at family as changing is to recognize the diversity that there are in what we call this term family. How do we define family? Well, here I would just refer to the family basically in terms of the socially recognized legitimate family form consisting of legally married parents, children born within the legal union. But at the same time, we have to recognize that there are a lot of diversities that's coming along. Fortunately, over the years, we do see that in legal arrangements covering public housing, income tax deduction, CPF, etc., there is a suggestion of this increasing awareness of the existence in diversity of actually family types in the policy, but there is still much room to recognize family forms that differ from the actual legal marriage type. So I'd like to set this discussion mainly from the aging policy perspectives, given my interest in it. And if you look at Singapore's aging policy, we all know that it is a very family-centric one to begin with. So the family-centric policy can be seen in this many helping hands approach, outlining the family as the first line of support. So what does the first line of support means here? From this report on the aging population, we believe, it says that we believe that the family is the primary care unit and the bedrock of support for seniors, and family must be supported and strengthened in its ability to care for its older members to ensure that institutionalization remains a measure of the last resort. So this focus has stayed consistent since the first National Report on Aging Policy Recommendation was implemented in 1984. So this whole focus on the family as caregiver for its older members, in fact, of course, have invited a lot of criticisms. For example, one is that there's so much emphasis on familism, you give family members very little choice, because this idea of familism reinforces the notion that family care is the best for frail older persons, although family members expected as caregiver may not be the most suitable and qualified to provide care. But I think the criticisms that we all have about this whole family-centricness is not so much to be against the idea of family should provide care, but more of the objection of perhaps a kind of a fatigue towards this overtly explicit message that family must care in a certain way. In fact, expectations on the family norm, in other countries are not as common. The role of families is often assumed and implied instead of being overly reminded, like in Singapore, with this kind of enshrining with the Maintenance of Parents Act. So the government's frequent emphasis on family and aging care may in a way suggest the uncertainty ahead about whether we can really rely on the family as a first line of support for older members in our society. Some may see that, well, the government is overreacting, because if you look at various indications, there are, of course, a lot of reports, surveys, polls that shows that Singapore family is strong, Singaporeans value family, they are committed to the family institution, and this even applies to the millennials that are below 30 years old, seen as the group most likely to abandon the so-called traditional values like filial piety. So this example of the report notes the, shows the positive sides of families and the strong strength of families in Singapore, but also notes the gap between desire and reality. So for example, people would desire to have a strong relationship, family relationship, but in reality, we spend so little time with the family because of work and other commitments. And among the older generations, there are also a lot of studies that shows that, you know, most of them like to age in place, want to grow old in their own homes, like to have children taking care of them, have children living together in, with them, if, especially when they are frail. But at the same time, majority are worried about who will take care of them in old age. So recent reports, such as the Lien Foundation and NTUC income report, show more of the younger age group, 30 to 44, as worried about growing old. More are worried about the ability to age in place. So they want to be independent, not to depend on the children, even when the children is available. So the report also shows that the older age group show preference for senior apartments or nursing homes as alternative living arrangements, about 50 to 60% of them say that. And for the younger group, there are more interest in retirement homes, in assisted living, and other kinds of arrangements that outside what we conventionally know. So given this contradictory trends of the likelihood of a strong family to continue, but on the other hand, this reservation to expect care from the family, I think both scenarios are possible. First, by 2065, it is possible that what are we doing now, you know, this current approach of family-centric focus will continue. It may further be strengthened. What we have done in terms of family-friendly workplaces, support for caregivers, financing help for healthcare financing and retirement financing and so forth, it should go on and it should be further strengthened. And then family will perhaps become much more important to all of our lives because there are so few family members now, looking at the demographics, that everyone becomes very precious. But the second scenario is where family is not there, then what other kind of relationships can there be to provide the kind of support for us? Okay, I'm not going to talk about financing here because CPF, annuity, various healthcare points are actually already in place now. And if it is working, if it is done well, I think it's going to provide a substantial, it will provide good support in that sense for older age in 50 years' time. But let's look at other possible scenarios in instrumental and emotional support. So for example, I ask people, you know, because of, after knowing that I'm going to talk here, I ask a lot of people, what's going to happen if family is not going to be your support? Many of them told me friends. They say, oh, they have very good friends. You know, friends are possible to be like a family to them. I remember interviewing one in one of my projects on caregivers. I interviewed the one interviewers, and we always gave them this kind of circles, you know, concentric circles, and said, okay, you are in the middle. Who do you see? You know, if you say this person is your close friend or this person is close to you in your network, then where do you place this person? So this interviewer is, almost 60, single. She's taking care of her mother with dementia at home. She has a sister, also single, and then together they are the caregivers. When I ask her who is, you know, her inner circle of support there, and it seems natural to think that, well, she might probably be putting her sister living together and her sibling, a family, but she in fact put two friends. She indicated two friends as in the inner circle because, and these are friends from her former workplaces and who have been providing a lot of emotional support, especially for her. The second possibility is neighbors. You know, a lot of people may think that neighbors, a lot of surveys, I mean, have shown that in Singapore, we do not really quite know our neighbors well. And that's very different from, you know, the kampong days. But I think the community help patterns in low-income rental flats that I have come across would provide us with some insights. Years ago, I did a qualitative study, quite looking at the older people living alone, and many of the respondents were from public rental flats. In that study, I found that mutual support is in fact quite strong among the older people who are living in these rental flats, especially when they have lived there for many years. So there's this rental flat particular where they have lived for almost 30 years, and they really show support as across racial considerations. And just last week, I read a student thesis focusing on a community bonding among residents in rental flats, which concurred with my earlier observations. That is a good piece of work. She surveyed the rental flat residents, compared the results with the HDB 2013 household survey to test out the three hypotheses that she set up from the literature review of mostly of Western literature. So her hypothesis is, well, compared to the general population of HDB, public rental flat dwellers will show a low frequency of neighborly interactions. They will have weak neighborly relations. Second hypothesis is they will have a low sense of belonging and community compared to the HDB residents in the survey. And thirdly, that the public rental flat will have no, the dwellers will have no engagement with the community as regularly as the HDB residents. But all this three hypotheses could not be established. In fact, mutual help was found to be quite strong in her study, particularly when they are living within the same block and including even providing and receiving financial help. So by extension, I'm thinking that, you know, we are talking about assisted living, we're talking about retirement housing, we're talking about new kinds of housing for later life. Then how can neighbors in that sense become an important point? Because you're going to have new neighbors and so forth. How do they become an important point of emotional support, instrumental support for each other? Now, the third point is a bit of a wild idea in this part of the world, maybe, is pets. You know, here it shows that this report says that 12 to 27% of pet owners include their pets in the will to receive inheritance. So pets are significant as emotional support for people living alone, something that we have seen much more happening. And of course, some people will say that, no, why don't we just include, you know, pets as part of our family register and so forth. But that's some point for your thoughts. And then finally, I think Mariam has talked a lot about this, about robots. I work in Japan, and I always like to visit those robot shows in Japan. I met Pepper this year when I was in one of the aging care exhibitions. Japan, of course, have been developing a lot in robotic to provide instrumental care, like lifting of the older people and so forth. But recently, it's interesting that they have also developed into emotional kind of support. So Pado is one very interesting one where they have research to show that it has in fact quite provided good emotional support for older people. And then Pepper is a new one that is said to be a robot who can read emotions. So we don't know how much robot is going to develop in the next 50 years, but there's likelihood that perhaps we will all have one at home for different purposes. So my time is up. So I'm just thinking about how good, you know, were all this alternative in replacing the family, substituting the family, providing an alternative way to fulfilling our relationships, support that we need for well-being in old age. But I think it's important to think that family is changing, but it may not have to be changing to be weaker. It can be strengthened depending on what kind of, well, maybe technology is one, what kind of other solutions and relationships we pull in to help us as we age. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Leng Leng. Norman and I decided we're just much too old-fashioned to rely on robots for our social emotional support. I don't know about you, Mariam. Well, so we had three very interesting presentations. Let me just do a quick recap. Norman offered you three models. The first is the hard multiculturalism that we are somewhat used to today, but what is distinctive about it is the piecemeal sort of application of provisions for different ethnic groups for different issues. The second is the model of benign neglect. For all those in the room who talk about a post-racial Singapore, this will be your much favored model, where you relieve the state from having to deal with society based on religion, and you push that much closer to the private sphere. The third model is what Norman said was the evolutionary model. Sounds a bit revolutionary, actually, but it's really to move society even more definitively towards targets. And I think you would agree, Norman, that the new system of elected presidency is that sort of soft target model that you're looking at, right? Yeah. So my, let me just, with that recap, prime Norman, what did you take away from the public discussion about the elected presidency that will give you a hint as to, not just the people in the room, but give you a hint as to where society would stand if you pose the question of which of these three models would you prefer? And I think answer that question with specific regard to how the racial minorities would address those models. I think that's the key one. I think with the debate on the elected presidency, we found that there was a diversity of views even among the racial minorities who was, for whom the system was targeted. They did not uniformly, unanimously feel that this was going to be a great help to them. So, Norman, where do you think people will stand on that? Not yet. Think about it. Now, Mariam took us through another very interesting presentation. I think when she discussed what if we cease to accept immigrants, she shared with us a picture of Singapore's future, and she shared with us two key drivers of that future, two key drivers of change. Technological change, whether we have a broadly diffused technological revolution, which is an ongoing one, or whether we'll have discontinuous technological change, which is more unpredictable, and we're not sure which way it will go. Then on the other axis, she talked about whether we become a more inclusive society, or one that leaves people out, that's a very unequal society. And if you recall, she had four scenarios: the great AI society, where tech is great and it's inclusive; the incremental diffusion society, where technological change is discontinuous, but yet, wherever we can, we will jump on the bandwagon, right? Then on the other side, where there is technological diffusion, but it results in an unequal society. So that is the divided dystopia. Very unhappy about immigrants at that point in time. And then finally, the last picture was of discontinuous tech and unequal society, in which case you have a balkanized, a set of balkanized ecosystems, everybody playing in their own little space. Each has a different possibility for immigration. And finally, you shared with us the trade-offs. Very painful trade-offs using the projections from the US about how if we even cease to take immigrants and that would cost us 1% GDP growth, using the figures of the US, you are highlighting the costs to us if we were to sacrifice that growth. So that's a key question put out there for us. But I think, Mariam, you know, help us a little bit, because the question is not just about dollars and cents. In a way, springboard a little bit off what Norman is saying. And I think the question is, how do we better integrate the immigrants that we'll probably all agree we need, both at the low-wage, low-skill work, where we just don't have enough Singaporeans who want to do that work, and at the high-wage, high-level knowledge workers who themselves are caricatured
as living in balkanized ecosystems of their own. So I think, does any, you know, does a business person or a person who wants to present us a business case of having immigrants have an answer to the social question? Okay. Finally, Leng Leng, thank you so much for your presentation and the alternatives you highlight to us, to family. In fact, many of us will say we value our friends even more than our family. But in Singapore, we have many laws and many lots of support for ensuring that family comes first. The key one that comes to mind that is probably the harshest is the maintenance of family law. I think, you know, most of us in the room will feel that family is important. But what of those who feel that their family has done nothing for them, in fact, has been a source of unhappiness? Is it fair? Is it time for us to question whether we still need that law? And what is the future of that law? So three questions to kick off, and then it's your turn, the audience. I'm done, because after that, I'm just controlling traffic. So please get ready, okay? So quick responses, Norman, then Mariam, and then Leng Leng. Over to you.
Thanks for that, Gillian. So if I understand your question correctly, what you're asking me is, what would my impression be based on the debate on the changes to the elected presidency? So and then based on that debate, where would people stand with the three models, right?
Yes.
The traction they would get. My first impression is very positive, actually, because we actually managed to have a discussion on multiculturalism as it should be practiced in Singapore, as what we like to be able to see how it be practiced, and nobody got very angry. Everybody did it in a very civil manner. So I think as a society, what the debate showed is that we've been quite happily moving along and maturing. And where would they stand then based on the debate? Clearly there is no consensus, obviously, where society stands on this. There were elements that were clearly arguing for would probably fall into the benign neglect camp, right? So we shouldn't tinker with these things and this should be left to the people to slowly evolve. And then there certainly was the other camp, which was in the Singaporean model camp. This is a piecemeal fix to see an outcome that we require. There was the argument. There was nobody, at least I'm not aware of, and you guys can correct me if I'm wrong, arguing for the target model, which wouldn't enshrine it to say by that we have to have one by X number of years, but rather the target model then would suggest we should try to get a minority, democratically elected minority president by year X, and then let's look back to see why it isn't happening, and we should attend to those issues. But I don't think anybody, at least I'm aware of, that was suggesting that.
So we do have a target system. We actually then said we'll have a reserve system.
Yeah.
So it is a target which kicks in case the normal processes don't work.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's how would that fall into your three boxes?
Oh, you're pushing me on this one, Gillian. I'm unsure whether I would put that in the current model or the target model.
I
suspect it just goes into the current model because if we did the target model,
yes,
then you'll have to have some introspection to figure out why you don't think it's going to happen and to attend to these issues.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. And finally, how do you think the racial minorities would view those models? Anything in particular you want to say?
I don't think there's consensus, like I said. I think whether you're a person who's a minority in Singapore or majority, I think there's no way of using ethnicity to put somebody in one of these camps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Good. All right. Satisfied customers? If not, please line up at the mics now. Over to Mariam.
So I think your question was on basically how do we handle the social integration.
Yes.
And actually, I didn't get to talk too much about the last slide, but that would have addressed some of that. Right? So I think, as I said, everybody has a part to play here. Integration is important. Mm-hmm. And my last call was actually for the immigrants themselves to actually make the effort to immigrate, to integrate.
Yes.
So I think if I just break it down into the different stakeholders for governments, a few direct and indirect things, right? So, you know, how do you foster an inclusive culture? You're doing things, and you can use, to some extent, you can shape that, right? Because I think every society has probably a certain level of acceptance as to how much foreigners they can actually assimilate. Mm-hmm. And that number will actually change over time. But you can shape it by some extent by, for example, in France, if you want to become a French citizen, mm-hmm. you have to be able to speak French, right? So I think language is a very important thing because, mm-hmm. you know, we heard Jeremy say that the first step is listening. I think the steps are actually listening, understanding, and then actually talking and having that dialogue. So, you know, I think language actually becomes quite important for the government to think about. And then indirectly, I think...
And then in that case, if I stop you there, you're just talking about English. That's it.
Yes, actually.
Okay.
And I think indirectly, I think it's the things you do actually for the citizens, right? So how you rethink social systems and policies, because at the end of the day, a lot of this is all about relative sense of how each group is doing. Mm-hmm. I think for businesses, I think it's time for actually businesses to actually also adopt more inclusive social strategies, uh-huh. and then also to shape a credible and an inclusive and trust-inspiring narrative in this. So, you know, if you have a program where you actually build a local talent pipeline, make sure people know about it, right? A very interesting example I saw was in the US, there is a firm, a venture capital firm. So I started my career in venture capital, so I have a bit of affinity for it, called Unshackled Ventures. And it actually is a firm that funds only immigrant entrepreneurs because immigrant entrepreneurs actually have a lot of trouble getting their H-1B visa when it's not sponsored by a company. And so what they do is beyond just giving funding, they actually act as employer sponsors for these H-1B visas. But the way they look at the criteria for investing, I think one of the things they say is they want to make sure they have a target of actually creating companies that will create 100,000 American jobs. Now, that changes the conversation, right? And I think for citizens, I mean, I think we have to play our part too. I think we have to be open, kind, and gracious, because I think, you know, that is the way we should be if we are going to be... there's a song, actually, by the composer of a national anthem that's probably a bit less well-known. It's called Orang Singapura, which describes what it means to be a true blue Singaporean. And if I translate it, it goes something like, if you're born a true Singaporean, your heart must be kind, filled with courtesy and grace. And I think that's what we actually really need to think about and if we think about how we're going to integrate immigrants.
Oh dear, Norman, you and I, do we qualify? Kind, courteous and gracious.
You're all three. Come on.
Okay, I thought we were all the bad guys here. Thank you, Mariam, for that. If you have anything to add to the conversation about immigrants, please get to the mic soon, okay? Leng Leng, before we cut to Paul.
Hi. Well, in fact, the maintenance of family law is not something that's only happening in Singapore. If you look at other countries, there are a lot of other countries that have such laws that stipulate that you should be supporting your parents. So even in the US as well. But sometimes when I read the cases, for example, in the US, it is the, for example, nursing home. Your parents go into the nursing home. It's a nursing home is the one that wants you know, to sue the children to pay for the nursing home expenses and so forth. So that could be quite ugly. That could get into, if parents choose to go very luxurious nursing home and expecting the children to be paying. So I think from my experiences with, talking to people who are in, especially if they're low income, they do not have contact with their adult children, it seems that the law is not very effective because a lot of people out there that have no connections with their children, is in dire need for financial help, are not going through that route because they don't want that, maybe they don't want to wash the dirty linen in public and so forth. But But because the law is there, sometimes it really forces, it disadvantages those people who really can't contact their children, can't get any support from their children, but cannot get money from, you know, cannot get public assistance and so forth, because record shows that they do have their children that should be supporting them. So in a way, the law may not be really helping people like this. And then I also realized that I have a colleague, in fact, is working, her research is precisely looking at the adult children that are involved with this, being called to the, because of this law. And a lot of tussles and unhappiness, in fact, is between, among the siblings. Because, you know, one might say, why am I paying for your parents and you are not doing so? So a lot of other complexities are out there. It's not as simple as, because my parents need help and I don't pay for them, then, you know, I evoke the law. So it's a lot about emotions as well. And the law is pretty interesting because it's reciprocity, right? It's based on reciprocity. So if you can show evidence as children that, hey, my parents didn't, my father didn't take care of me, and you could actually go away with it. But then in the event of doing so, of course, it breaks relationships. Yes. So I would say that the law started to have reconciliation since 2011 and seems to be doing quite well in being able to help families to really see the situation. A lot of children, in fact, say that they hated the father, especially a lot of cases are with fathers. So they hated the fathers, but when they look at, they haven't seen the father for maybe 40 years. And this case came out, they're being called to, and they met the father, and they say they changed their mind because the father has become somebody else. He's so old now, he really needs help. So some children are doing it not because it's their father, it's because of this, they feel that they need to help somebody who is in that kind of situation. Yeah, so if the reconciliation measures are doing well and strong, I suppose we could really relook the law itself.
Thank you, Leng Leng. All right, so that's great. We have three questions. Let's take them together. Speakers, get ready. So Paul first, and then the gentleman there, and then the gentleman there. Okay, Paul.
Thanks, Gillian. You know, the condition you had for me coming here was to ask a question, so I'm going to do that. My question is actually based on the assumptions from your presentation and from Mariam's. They seem to be based on the assumption that GDP growth is a good thing, and it's something that's really, really important. If we don't get GDP growth, it'll be a disaster. But as you know, I believe in Schumacher's argument that growth for the sake of growth is the philosophy of the cancer cell. And, my wife and I, we have no children. So in the view of the last speaker, I guess we are doomed to work until we die. But one of the good things is we don't have to take holidays during school holidays. So during school holidays, when 1 million people leave the country or long weekends, Singapore is a really pleasant place because you can get into a restaurant, the roads are not crowded. You know, we say when we have 2.5 million people, it's a great city to live in. Okay. With all the infrastructure. So my question is, are we really taking this assumption a bit too far? And stressing the infrastructure on our little city-state so greatly? And is this because there is this obsession with GDP growth at all costs? For example, I just heard from a second person that in the medical profession, the argument is, when there are jobless doctors, we tell the Singaporeans, too bad, you've got to suck it up, because there are people who are lining up, waiting for the jobs, willing to work for $3,000 a month. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Paul. Okay, over there, please. Yes.
Yeah, Han from Risense. I have a question for Mariam. Now, I accept the assumption. So if we accept the premise that immigrants are needed to keep the economy competitive, then how then do we help the angry voters, in quotes, make peace with the immigrants who are seen to be taking their jobs?
Okay. Thank you very much. And Johannes.
Yeah, Johannes. Hello. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Johannes from Black Box Research here. Actually, I'll have a related question, but I oppose it. I mean, I'll approach it from a very different view. I would say in the four scenarios, is in the world, and Singapore to some extent at the moment moving to the negative scenario on the left. So it's not opening itself up to immigration. It's actually closing itself to some extent. It is making life more difficult for small business owners with these restrictions. And to some extent that is because of political pressure, not because of economic rationale or necessity. So my question is for Mariam, business as usual, is the top right scenario possible for Singapore, or do you think the policymakers need to change their approach?
Okay, thank you. Wow, Mariam, you're in the hot seat, but if anybody else wants to jump in, please do. Before you answer that, remember that Jeremy, in panel two, discussed that topic of whether we should pursue you know, other ways of talking about success than economic growth. And remember his figures from the opinion poll by Gallup? Guess what? When Singaporeans rated us on all those different indicators, when it came to prosperity, 34% said we did all right on employment opportunities. That was the worst mark on the table. And that's economic. The second worst mark was 45% said that they are okay and optimistic about their living standards over the next year. And that was also economic. So in fact, the ratings seem to suggest we're doing good on many, many fronts, but not the economic one. So Paul, very strange, isn't it? Okay, I don't say anything else and I'll leave the time to Mariam.
Okay. I thought this might happen. Okay, so yes, I totally agree with you. You know, growth at all costs is not what we want. And in fact, you know, I think we've actually discussed it already quite a lot today. But I think what we do want is inclusive growth. And before you get inclusive growth, you actually need to have some growth, right? So I think the question is, what is that level of growth that we are comfortable with? And I don't think we're talking anymore about 8-10% growth that, you know, perhaps some people felt we were chasing before. Mm-hmm. As I said, I think PM last week said that we were looking at a growth target of 2-3%. Mm-hmm. To me, that sounds fairly reasonable. So I think, you know, it's all we have to just calibrate it in terms of what exactly we mean by you know, growing at all costs. It's not, that's not really where we are right now. Okay. I think next I'll address the question of how to make you know, the angry voters happy. Mm-hmm. Right? Look, I think this is a journey, as all these things are. And it's partially about communication, but there are actually specific things you do have to do. So I think also being smart about your immigration policies. So for example, being a bit more targeted in some sectors, you may, I think today is quite broad-based in terms of you know, the different quotas that are set for different sectors. Mm-hmm. Perhaps we need to be a bit more discerning about that. Of course, in new growth sectors where we need the skills, need the knowledge, we need people to train, we can afford a little bit more. But where we need to have where there are actually quite a lot of Singaporeans who can do the same job already, then, you know, we can be a little bit more strict on that. And then I think, again, the going back to my point earlier about needing to also rethink your social systems and policies, I think, you know, that will also go some way to making the angry voters, hopefully will make, go some way to making the angry voters happy. Then I think the last question about the scenario. So I actually don't quite know where we are today. So I think we are, because look, I think it's still playing out quite early right now, right? Yes, it seems like we are either heading into the top left or the divided dystopia scenario. But you could also make an argument that, you know, I really don't think we're heading towards the top right, because that's actually quite a discontinuous jump in technology. What at least we seem to be more likely to see right now is a more steady evolution of technology. Mm-hmm. And so we are somewhere between incremental diffusion and a divided dystopia.
Mm-hmm. How do the Skills Future program for, how does the Skills Future program in you know, fit into that transition?
So, you know, I think if you think about the one thing that you do need is to make sure that, as I said, don't just protect the Singaporean core, elevate the core. And that actually means, you know, going back to retraining, right? Reskilling, skills mastery, and actually, you know, plain old modern day apprenticeship. And that's really important. Maybe a slightly more provocative view. I think in the great AI society, one thing I didn't mention was, well, you know, if robots are doing all the work, I think there'll still be jobs for people, but it may be, you know, you may be working 25 hours a week instead of 40 hours. It's not too bad, right? You can't complain.
Depends on what you're paid.
And so what that means is you have more free time. Yeah. And so this whole idea of lifelong learning and you know, skills reskilling that you see in Skills Future is not only, you know, it's not only economic and direct. I mean, I think very few people actually think that the jobs, the classes they go to will land them a job the next day, right? But it does make sure that you expand your horizons, think about what you can learn, and, you know, actually perhaps, you know, I don't think we should all go out there and try to be CS majors. I think that would be a disaster for Singapore. But at least we can all learn to embrace technology and use it in the best possible way.
Okay. All right. Our time's almost up. So
Sorry,
are there any more burning questions? I recognize Bremer and one more person at the back. Yes. Okay. Rapid fire round.
Okay.
Very short question.
Thank you.
Three questions. Okay, go.
Thank you, everyone, for your presentations. I've got only one question for Professor Norman Vasu on your evolutionary model. It took us 51 years to get where we are, and also entrenched to a large extent race and religion. And this is a projection up to 2065. If we follow the evolutionary model, and I looked at the five categories, in your opinion, what do you think we should start cracking at, and can we reach that in by 2065? Thank you.
Okay, more specific on the final model. Okay, gentleman there, please. Yes.
Yeah, hi. Good afternoon. My name is Jia Wen. My question is with regards to race and integration in society. So it seems to me that this current generation of Singaporeans is actually a lot more homogeneous than in the past. So for example, we all speak English and Singlish. And I feel like we all share more similar life values and life experiences than before. Certainly, I think that I have a lot more friends from different races than my parents did. So, to me, my personal observation is that the biggest divisions in society today are not really between Singaporeans of different races, but really between Singaporeans and non-Singaporeans.
Okay.
So I think my question to Norman and maybe Gillian is, do you agree that society is becoming more homogenous or rather more heterogeneous but in different ways? And how do you see our policies evolving in response to that? So for example, do you ever see a future where we have housing and school quotas also, not just for the races, but also for Singaporeans and immigrants?
Right.
Thank you.
Okay. Norman and Mariam, please. I'm not a speaker. Okay, final question. Thank you, Ambassador.
Thank you, Gillian. Two quick questions. First one to Norman and Gillian. Will the EP election bring about greater unity, or will it take us back in terms of our understanding of not only multiculturalism, but also meritocracy, two fundamentals for Singapore? Question for Mariam. You did not touch about immigration and race. When policy was first announced, in fact, I was asked, and I said it's a good policy, but please make sure that the percentage of Malays do not drop drastically. But in fact, ESM assured me, don't worry, because that time the Malays were 4.6, I think, reproduction rate, so high. But now Malays have dropped from 15 to 13%. Indians have grown. Will there be a reverse? For example, Indians become 13, 14, 15, and the Malays become 8%. And what are the ramifications for that?
Thank you. All right. I'm not going to answer a question. Norman, it's all yours, okay? Okay, nothing for Leng Leng? All right, so speakers, can I invite Norman to start, then Mariam, and Leng Leng, just give us your final word, then we'll wrap, okay? So over to Norman.
Yeah, great question, Bremer. What do we do, you know, as we move towards 2065? Which one do we attend to based on that list that I gave, right? I wouldn't actually attend to those things. My argument would, I wouldn't tweak what we already have. So what I would suggest is that we should look at perhaps something that can be attended to quite easily, which aspired to, which would be educational qualifications and perhaps occupations too. So it's a novel idea to think it through because it pulls all of society together to work towards one end game, right? So private enterprise has to get involved, right? The government has to get involved. So everyone's working together towards a particular goal. So I would attend to those two things rather than the list that I put up.
So just to be clear, you're saying a certain targeted percentage from this racial group to be studying this discipline, yeah. And
you want X number of doctors by year, X you want X number of doctors by year Y to reflect the racial demographic of Singapore.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah. Okay. So that would be the suggestion. Whether we're becoming more homogenous,
yeah.
Well, we certainly developed it was an odd way to develop. Well, not that odd. It's an odd way to develop some form of commonality. It was via xenophobia, spike in nationalism as well. Nationalism is an interesting thing. It makes you take pride in something you've never done and hate people that you've never met. it's like, we won the war. You know, so... Yeah, I think the intra-racial differences are greater now, right? Because it hasn't been a seamless plug and play of ethnicity where, you know, we have falling birth rates for example, Chinese people. Let's take another Chinese person from over there and bring him here, and then we're all the same, right? They all should get along. Clearly that hasn't developed as smoothly as one would have liked. But there is a positive there. I mean, there clearly is a sense of Singaporeanness that's being developed. But it's still very hard to articulate that commonality. I mean, you bring up Singlish and you bring up English. I struggle to think what else would we use as markers for Singaporeanness.
Okay, but the question is, if just as you said, year X of doctors from this group, so the question was, do we actually do those quotas, Singaporean versus foreigners, if you feel that the distinction is really not as severe between the ethnic groups as between Singaporeans and non-Singaporeans?
I don't get the question, Jillian, go do it again.
Yeah. Okay, so I think the gentleman was asking whether you believe that the greatest distinction today is not between or among the ethnic groups, but between, as you said, Singaporeans, yeah, and non-Singaporeans.
Yeah.
So in which case, applying your model, would you then want to fix targets for different parts of society, whether it's educational?
Yeah.
So that many Singaporeans and non-Singaporeans in this space and that.
I mean, that's why this target model is interesting to think about, because you could set it to anything. Whether you want to attend to your citizenry with regards to the racial demographics to reflect that of your citizens, or you want to attend to it with regards to immigrants and Singaporeans, that's all fine. But I won't make a call on this one on how to go about it. But it is definitely portable. You can use it for whatever group you have concern with, right?
So then the ambassador's question is, now that we've applied somewhat an idea of a target through the elected presidency system, does it make for greater unity or not?
Yeah, I have no answer to that. Jury is out on it. We've got to see how it unfolds. I'm going to sit on the fence on this one. I really don't have any data to swing it either way, really.
Does it help that the narrative is to bring about unity, because then each group will be represented over time?
Yeah. But jury's out. Like I said, Jillian, you can't make a call on this one.
Okay.
Yeah, we'd be irresponsible to do so.
All right. Okay. Now over to Mariam, please.
I think I'll take the first question from the gentleman over there first. So, are we becoming more homogenous? Actually, I think we are becoming more homogenous in some sense, but also a lot more heterogeneous in some senses also. And I think this is just a reflection of the fact that, you know, we're all developing lots of different identities. But one thing that is clear is that I think over the course of several years, I think Singapore identity is emerging, right? We all know a Singaporean when we go overseas. We all like the same nasi lemak. It's there. So, but it's not because I think we we're more homogenous, but I think we have a common identity and we are comfortable with that identity. Now, on the question of whether I think we need to be a bit, I think the question was whether we have to be more interventionist in ensuring integration between foreigners and non-foreigners. Look, I think the goal is, I have a clearer perspective on the goal. And I think the goal is that there should be integration. So I would like to see blocks of flats with both foreigners and non-foreigners. I think if we end up with them always being separate, that would make it a bit more difficult to integrate, because it's in the lifts, it's in the void decks that you actually get that interaction, right? But does it have to be done in following the old recipe of setting quotas? Yeah. Or can it be something a bit more organic and you know, let it bubble up, given, you know, we're now in the 21st century. So that I think, that frankly, I don't know. And actually, for questions where I don't know, I go back to, I think, you know, I talked about adaptive policymaking. One of the key tenets there is experiment. Right, so perhaps do some experimentation, and I think we are doing some of it already in, you know, when it comes to companies by having these fair employment policies, yeah. And yeah. You know, let's just watch and see whether that becomes something organically natural, or whether, you know, something more interventionist is still needed. Yes. And then to the third question of, yeah, I think it was about what was. How do we feel about the impact on the Malay population, or at least the representation? So I think, first of all, I guess I go back to the data. Based on what you had shared, Gillian, I think what I saw at least was that there hasn't been actually a huge shift in the percentage of Malays in Singapore. Look, personally, you know, I'm very comfortable whether I am, you know, I'm used to being in an environment where, you know, in school, sometimes I was the only Malay in the class. I can work effectively, very effectively there. I have clients in KL, you know, in Malaysian GLCs where it's all Malays, and I work very well there too also. Mm-hmm. Because with each of them, my identity is different, right? Uh-huh. So, you know, it's just a fellow Malay, and I speak Malay to them in Malaysia. I think that works well. In class, you know, I have a different identity, right? I'm a student, and I'm a classmate of the people that I love to actually be around. So for me, that's okay. But of course, that may not be the same for everybody else, right? So I think there may be some segment in society that's from the Malay population in particular that cares about this. And I think, you know, I think the how it has evolved is probably not by accident, right? Because I do think probably on balance, maintaining that ratio is probably important. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's actually something that's actually quite easy to control, right? Okay. Because it is entirely in the government's prerogative, you know, who they grant citizenships to, who they don't, and things like that. Mm-hmm. But I think just watch the assumptions that are implicit in this, which is that, you know, do we believe that the Malay population fertility rate will continue to be higher, or will it actually converge towards the mean? Mm-hmm. And also, if we, you know, there's also an implicit assumption that, you know, within the group of immigrants, you don't have actually, you know, Malays or Indonesians in there. So I think both those assumptions, one could question.
Okay, thank you. Leng, any last final words?
Well, I think one of the speaker on the floor talk about having to work to very old if you don't have children. Yeah. But actually, if you have children, you probably have to work older because you have to be a grandparents, you have to do grandparenting and, you know, provision of care and things like that. So, and I think family, having children more and more to Singaporeans are really not about economic nowadays, because you don't really reap much benefits from having children. Maybe you have to pay more to sustain them, even if they're, you know, when they become adults. So it's more really an experience, process of personal growth and enjoying an experience and so forth. So so I think we all know our government is very much into pushing for population growth. So it will be good that as much, you know, don't think as much as pushing it as a way of national duty, I think it should be also really being seen from the point of view of the whole life course experience of being a parent. So finally, I think my colleague in NUS, Feng and Strawn, has done a survey on successful aging, on you know what is successful aging to Singaporeans. And they found that 95% of the people say to be independent is very important, to be independent and not to rely on children.
Thank you. Okay, very good. So to the first question, what if we ignore race and religion? We have a few models. The question is then, which will make for greater unity across Singapore, right? As brought up by Ambassador, that key question. I think that's what we are asking. What if we cease to accept immigrants? You shared with us, Mariam, the sort of trade-offs, but I think we are concerned about much more than the dollars and cents. And so you had many suggestions on how the different stakeholders across society, including business, can do better to bring down the sense of threat of immigrants and bring up the level of acceptance of immigrants. What if the family is no longer the fundamental building block of society? Leng Leng, you shared with us that Singaporeans, even young Singaporeans, believe in family, although they are concerned about how they will go on in life. And you also shared that many are finding that they have meaningful and supporting relationships among friends, neighbors, especially among the poor, which is surprising, and that we can explore many other avenues. So with that, I hope you feel that it was time well spent listening to my three friends on this panel, and you'll join me with a hearty round of applause for their effort.